if that happens, or we may now have to start saying when this happens. The climate in which culture started and grew everything in Britain would change radically, and Britain would move to the climate of Newfoundland and Labrador. Short of nuclear war, there is nothing that can bring about a result like that for Britain.
Taggio Mueller said something that's like chilled me to the bone. So that the arc of history is long, but bends towards justice. But in a climate collapse scenario, the arc of history is short and bends towards fascism.
Yeah.
Which is like both pithy and just, oh God, I get chills. We don't have to get into absolutely every aspect of what's happening with the AfD in Germany or the Reform Party here in the UK, or with J.D. Vance and Trump in the United States talking about Springfield, Ohio. The fear of migration seems bound to get more fuel going forward because of the need for people who just decide, like, yeah, I'm never going to be able to bring up a family where I am now, so sod it, I will take my chances and go somewhere else. That seems like it'll be a better shot. This is Wicked Problems, and I am Richard Delavan. Flooding in the Sahara. Drought in the Amazon, while fires in the Pantanal choke 60% of Brazil with smoke. Millions without power in the southeastern United States after Hurricane Helene. And back here in Blighty, history will record the closure of the UK's last coal-fired station at the end of this month that saw more rainfall of any previous month on record. And yeah, it's definitely the wrong kind of rain.
Many areas of England are still bracing for flooding after some parts of the country experienced over a month's worth of rain in a matter of hours in the last few days. Some roads and schools have been closed today, and rail lines have been disrupted too.
It's long been predicted that this kind of instability was likely, but we imagined it would be a problem for, you know, the future. Not us. Or just at least, you know, would be a satisfying thing for a disaster flick. But extremely unlikely, you know, like an asteroid hitting the Earth, or an alien invasion, or giant mutant lizard coming out of the ocean to smash up Tokyo, or like the North Atlantic Current shutting down.
What about the North Atlantic Current?
What about it?
I got a call last night from Professor Rapson at the Headland Center. He thinks the current has changed.
Come on, Jack, how could that be?
The current depends upon a delicate balance of salt and fresh water.
We all know that.
Yes, but no one has taken into account how much fresh water has been dumped into the ocean because of melting polar ice.
Hold on, Jack, are you suggesting these weather anomalies are going to continue?
Not just continue, get worse. I think we're on the verge of a major climate shift.
I mean, what happens next in The Day After Tomorrow is so bone-crushingly stupid. New York destroyed and frozen over, and for some fallen politics, scenes of American refugees trying to cross the Rio Grande into Mexico, which was kind of cool. One climate scientist who was paid to watch the film said it was to climate science what Frankenstein was to heart surgery. It's the only blockbuster ever made, though, where climate change is explicitly the monster, not, you know, some metaphor standing in for it, like a big comet or something else. No, just that. And the film's writer told Salon this year that it's 20th anniversary, by the way, that in his first meeting with Fox's marketing team about the film after selling the script, someone told him, he reports, "Just to be clear, as per Fox's policy, we will not be using the words global warming when we market the film," which probably at the time felt a little bit weird, but actually probably turned out to be a commercially good decision because it made $4 for every dollar spent in terms of making the film, making it, it grossed about $2.8 billion worldwide. So, you know, pretty profitable. Despite getting a squishy green 45% on the Rotten Tomatoes tomatometer when the critics panned it. And it also made any climate scientist thinking about talking about the science underlying it, you know, however exaggerated the effects and shortened the time span, made it a thing you might get laughed out of the room if you were, say, on a stage in New York Climate Week being interviewed by David Wallace Wells, until this year.
What is a climate tipping point?
The tipping point is when a physical state is not changing because it is pushed further, but at some point self-amplifying feedbacks take over, and then it changes further without further pushing by itself, unstoppable. It's like if I push back here and wobble on my chair, I have to push, but from a certain angle on, I don't have to push anymore. It will just fall over. The AMOC is a huge flow of water that warm surface water goes northward along the entire Atlantic from South Africa, then returns as a cold current that works like a central heating system for the northern Atlantic region. A key reason why Europe, especially northwestern Europe, has a very mild climate for its latitude. And if you shut that down, that advantage will go. It will get a lot colder in especially Great Britain, Scandinavia. But there are other consequences of worldwide impact. One of them is a shifting of the tropical rainfall belts. That means the rainfall is not where people are used to it, where the tropical rainforests are. There it will be missed. And in other regions which are not used to these extremely high precipitation amounts, there will be flooding. And finally, disruption of marine biology in the whole North Atlantic. The Northern Atlantic is the only region of the world that has cooled in the last 100 years and keeps cooling down. And that is exactly the region where the AMOC delivers its heat and where the climate models predict that will cool when the AMOC slows down. So we see this happening. Also, that region, which is to the west of the British Isles, south of Iceland, has now the lowest salinity, so ocean water salt content, in 120 years of measurements, which again is an expected effect of an AMOC slowdown. Then there's a whole new type of studies, the so-called early warning signal studies, and they kind of indicate that it's quite likely already this century, probably even before 2050, that we could cross that tipping point.
That was Stefan Rahmstorf of the Potsdam Institute, whose research suggests that the odds of the AMOC shutting down has gone from pretty unlikely to 50-50 plus, as you heard, and not in like 300 years, but in, you know, our lifetime. And although it wouldn't put New York and London under glaciers in a week, it might make growing food outdoors in northwestern Europe impossible in the course of just a few summers. So there's that. So you can imagine, like, again, other than making a good disaster movie, how would you adapt for something like this? And what would that mean for how politics might change? Which is why we asked Dr. Anatol Lieven, you're director of the Eurasian program at the Quincy Institute in the United States, who's been on the show before, to come back on, because The Guardian published a piece of his last week talking about the implications of exactly what that might mean. So we asked him to come back on the program. And yeah, the effects here, in terms of some of these weather events, well, yeah, here's a business owner that Hugo Rifkind of Times Radio was speaking to in that earlier clip.
Lisa Meredith is manager at the Combe Hair Salon in Ruislip Manor that has suffered from the heavy downpour. Lisa, I'm sorry to hear about that. Tell us a bit about what you've been going through.
We opened the doors yesterday morning, ready to trade, and the whole place was covered in water and mud and silt.
Gosh. What's it like now?
We couldn't do any business yesterday. We had a major clean-up operation. We will be able to reopen. I think the biggest issue is, because it's happened to us before, about 7 or 8 years ago, we're uninsurable.
Right, oh wow.
So we can't get insured anymore, and that's the... So a lot of business, you know, like a lot of our business, our retail products and hair and everything, you know, extensions, yeah, ruined, and there's no way to get our money back.
Because this is the weird reality of the climate change effects we're already experiencing. We're really not likely to have the world turned upside down in one night. But most of us are going to become a lot more likely, not necessarily find the place that we're living uninhabitable so much as uninsurable, difficult. And very few people are talking about how to get ready for that. So that's a cheery note. We'll have Dr. Lieven in a moment, but thank you for your support. If you've become a paid subscriber at wickedproblems.earth, where we talk about solutions to many of these things, not just the problems. But if you haven't had a chance to do that, the best time would have been 6 months ago, but the second best time would be today. So we would really love it if you have a chance to give us a little bit of help to make sure we can keep doing this and bringing you this type of interviews and content and stories. At the very end, you'll find, for subscribers, some bonus material, the fuller version of that interview with David Wallace Wells and Stefan Rahmstorf, and a second final segment, only for subscribers. You'll be able to hear the president of the Heritage Foundation, who might be behind a little thing you might have heard of called Project 2025, who also has some interesting things to say at Climate Week about what a Trump win could mean. So, you know, it's either the North Atlantic Current or another orange menace. And now here's my interview with Dr. Lieven. Dr. Anatol Lieven, director of the Erasure Program at Quincy Institute, thank you for coming back on Wicked Problems.
Hi.
The Guardian published an article of yours that scared the bejesus out of me, which I think people have been worried about for really quite a long time, and you've like fired a flare gun to draw more attention to the idea that the, I mean, it's not quite the Gulf Stream, although the Gulf Stream is part of it, it's actually much worse than that, and how that might have security implications. So over to you, what was in the piece, and please tell me why I shouldn't be as scared as I am.
The thing is, we don't know exactly how scared you should be, because when you're looking at, you know, climate changes on this scale, it is impossible, you know, to be exact, precise in your predictions. But there is now a huge and growing body of scientific evidence to suggest that at certain points during the past ice ages, this current shut down as a result of the melting of ice much more quickly than people previously assumed. In other words, that this was not a process that took place over several centuries. It was a process taking place over a few decades or even a number of years. Now, that does now seem to be pretty firmly established. What we don't know is how close we may be to this point, because, of course, this is the whole problem with climate change science. There are so many variables. But, I mean, if you look at the trajectory of temperature rises, the records that have been broken this year, and the fact that in the Arctic, temperatures are rising much faster than in the world as a whole, this is clearly a non-negligible risk. And of course, there are other, you know, apart from the melting of the ice, there are other severe dangers in the Arctic. I mean, one of them is the melting of the permafrost and risking the release of very large quantities of methane. That has been identified as one of the tipping points, you know, that could basically face us with runaway climate change. And well, I mean, writing for a British paper, of course, I focused above all on Britain. If that happens, or I think, you know, we may now have to start saying when this happens, unless radical, you know, action is taken to limit climate change. The climate of Britain, I mean, the climate in which human civilization grew up, I mean, agriculture started and grew, everything in Britain would change radically, and Britain would move to basically the climate on, you know, the latitude where we sit, which would give us the climate of Newfoundland and Labrador. Now, that would, of course, completely transform British life. The costs of the adjustments would be immense. The psychological disruption would be immense. I mean, short of nuclear war, there is nothing that Russia and China, let alone Iran, can or indeed want to do to bring about a result like that for Britain. But the thing is, you know, I think Britain as such would probably survive because, you know, we do have great resources, great technical resources. But you would also be looking at colossal disruption across the whole of Western Europe. But the thing is that the Gulf Stream doesn't, as you said, just channel warm water north. It's a circular, as it, AMOC is, you know, circulation. It then brings cooler water down south to Western Africa, which also plays a key part in limiting temperatures there. We are already seeing severe ecological problems in Western Africa, to a lesser extent in America. And of course, these countries are not wealthy and relatively stable societies. They are highly dysfunctional, deeply impoverished states. Very often, including the very biggest of them, Nigeria, racked with ethnic and ethno-religious conflict, and in serious danger, even at present, of collapsing as states. Now, the population movements that would result from that would render existing levels of migration, which are already, of course, radically transforming European politics, would render those almost insignificant by comparison.
Yeah.
Now, what that indicates is that long before, you know, Britain actually, you know, begins to disappear under the waves, the pressures on Western democracy would become such that our political systems would collapse. Yeah. So anyway, that's what I wrote the piece about.
So it's, yeah, very cheery and so excited that we could get you on to bring up the national mood. That's awesome. You mentioned that this is not the first time this has ever happened in the climate record. One of the first books on this subject I read way, way back, Brian Fagan's The Long Summer. The Hollywood version of this, of course, which you, you know, thankfully for Guardian readers did not mention in your piece, is The Day After Tomorrow, which is this all happens again, like in a week, as yeah. opposed to a year or so, which is obviously silly, but the idea that If it's hyperbolic, which perhaps was unhelpful in drawing attention to how dangerous and how severe the consequences could be, the consequences, as you say, like short of actual nuclear winter, this is about as bad as you're going to imagine anytime soon. So you are, you know, again, have for many decades been a observer of the Securitat, you know, in the West and beyond. The military has been one of the most astute observers, both of the potential threats from climate change, and unfortunately, in some ways, because policymakers demand this, saying like, what would happen if the Arctic was ice-free? And like, what would that mean for geopolitics and geostrategy? But staying on the threat part, what can you tell us about the kinds of conversations that you either know about or imagine are going on within the security establishment about like the scenario planning for what that would mean? Is anybody actually even gaming this out? I mean, like how quickly that would happen? I mean, is there any, even any point, or would there just cease to be any governments that would function, you know, in the Northern Hemisphere or in the North Atlantic, you know, could meaningfully do anything about it? So if the, like the US Navy or the British Navy decided like, yeah, there's no point.
Well, I mean, I think that is part of it. You know, the threat is on such a scale that people simply become paralyzed. But you know, this is not certain. It's certainly not certain that it will happen. I mean, there are serious concerns that it could happen as soon as mid-century, you know, but
which is not very far away.
Which is not very far away. But that's not definite. I mean, there is still time, and no doubt government in some form would continue to function. But you see, the real problem is you mentioned that the military has been looking at this. And a few years back, I mean, both by the NATO military, the British, also by the Americans, there was some serious stuff about the global implications of this for security. But, you know, to my horror, more recently, just before, you know, this conversation, I was looking at a piece by the American Security Project, which has lots of ex-soldiers on its board, and which actually has in the past looked at climate change seriously, and indeed by military standards still does. But if you look at the global implications for climate change, what they are mostly looking at now is the threat that US bases will be flooded. That, for example, it'll be much more difficult to carry out training in camps, you know, like Quantico, because it'll be too hot. But the worst is in the Arctic, where, you know, the obvious threat from the Arctic is that the bloody ice melts, the permafrost melts, and as a result, the entire world climate goes to hell, with collapsing states and societies, you know, across large parts of the earth, and, you know, population movements that will collapse even surviving states. But what is the US security establishment and much of the European security establishment talking about? They're talking about the threat that Russia and China will be able to sail more ships through the Arctic because it will be ice-free. Now, what are they going to do with those ships? If it's, you know, the threat of nuclear submarines, well, that threat has existed for almost 60 years now. You know, the ice doesn't change it. But as far as, you know, more shipping, what are Russia and China going to do? Are they going to invade Baffin Island? I mean, no. But this is, you know, unfortunately, you know, we are dealing with a situation which our politicians increasingly, and including, of course, now more and more people supposedly on the left, like, you know, among the Greens, like the Greens in Germany, are simultaneously, you know, more and more aggressive in their international attitudes and policies, but know nothing actually about military affairs, you know, are incapable of analysing, you know, the reality of the battlefield in Ukraine, for example. And so defer, of course, to their militaries and their intelligence services and, you know, the whole penumbra ecology of think tanks often staffed by ex-intelligence and military people. And they, I mean, I'm not necessarily accusing them of conscious cynicism, but they are utterly shaped by, I mean, not just their institutional interests and institutional culture, but of course, I mean, it is a wider problem. I mean, people have been, human beings have been making organized warfare for, I don't know, 7,000 years now, something like that. And that has been the principal business of most states. And it just, with the partial exception, it must be said, of China and one or two places where the control of water was always a critical issue. But it just seems to be psychologically, culturally, institutionally impossible for these people to change their basic focus.
I was just going to say, neither you or I could be fairly described as a peacenik, although people who might hear this conversation, the beginning of it might go like, actually, gosh, these guys are like Intercept subscribers and like people who are on the loony left or, you know, pro-Putin apologists or whatever else, which neither you or I are, just to be super clear.
Yeah.
But I think it's sort of like looking at, you know, again, not going to use a like don't look up analogy, but essentially like something really bad's about to happen. And we're arguing about like place settings on the table at the Titanic rather than the iceberg that's in front of us. And I suppose that you and I were like, what are we talking about? So I guess for me, it's both, you know, terrifying and disheartening. But I wanted to ask you about something else you mentioned. You mentioned how this is changing politics. And we're only seeing the first glimmers of this. So we had a chap who's a fellow political scientist, although you might not consider him a peer, he's kind of taken a very different career path in life, Dr. Taggio Mueller, who is a, you know, kind of 25-year activist, plus having his PhD from Sussex, plus teaching occasionally, but mostly being a movement guy. And we had him on the show, we've had him on the show a couple of times, and he said something that's like chilled me to the bone. So the arc of history is long, but bends towards justice. But in a climate collapse scenario, the arc of history is short and bends towards fascism, which is like both pithy and just, oh God, I get chills every time I ever think about it, which is what you're saying. And we don't have to get into absolutely every aspect of what's happening with the AfD in Germany or with the Reform Party here in the UK, or indeed with JD Vance and Trump in the United States talking about Springfield, Ohio. But the fear of immigration, the fear of migration, which seems bound to get more fuel going forward because of the need of people who just decide like, yeah, I'm never going to be able to bring up a family where I am now. So sod it, I will take my chances and go somewhere else. That seems like it'll be a better shot. Like, it seems like we're not going to be going down on those numbers.
No.
So like, what is your, you know, give me the bear case and the bull case about like What do we do about that?
Well, I mean, the bull case, which is, of course, deeply unpleasant and unwelcome, but is obviously starting, well, across, you know, Europe, is just many more restrictions on entry. I think, I mean, certainly if Le Pen comes to power in France, and the odds must be on that in 2027, and if you get a government including AfD in Germany, you will sooner or later get simply the abolition of the right to asylum, which is frankly, I mean, already so utterly dysfunctional and chaotic. It is impossible to judge, mostly, I mean, who is a legitimate, or what is a legitimate refugee,
thank
for God's
you.
Sake.
Yes. I mean, this is something that I think, again, we've talked a little bit about the show, is that, you know, the idea of a climate refugee, right? The idea that, like, Australia has done some work in terms of trying to identify, you know, for those residents of Tuvalu, you know, who we know that their islands are going to be gone soon, and they're allowing a phased migration of a certain amount per year from Tuvalu to Australia, which again is fraught with problematic with all sorts of reasons. But at the very least, like, at least, you know, the Albanese government has actually decided, like, we're going to at least talk about it and, like, do something, as opposed to, like, basically we're just going to machine gun you on the beach if you try to come ashore, which seems to be the way a lot of politics are going in other markets. But I think the legitimacy question, like, what does a refugee actually mean anymore, is going to be very much stretched. And I think it's important to stress that. So please continue. I'm sorry.
No, sure. But you see, on the other hand, but this is for economic reasons, of course, the German government has just concluded an agreement with the Kenyan government to bring in 250,000 Kenyans to work in specific areas of the German economy. Now, what that suggests to me, because it's quite true, you know, we do need more immigrants, but this has to be a controlled process. And there have to be specific jobs waiting for them. And there has to be housing and specifically dedicated education so that they can be gradually integrated into the education system and society. Because the problem at present is that you just have a completely inchoate mass of people coming into the country with no planning, no housing prepared, no education facilities which will actually help them. They're just being put straight into German and other schools with a colossally disruptive effect and really driving, you know, local resistance to the process. But,
sorry, this is the bull case. What's the bear case?
The bear case, frankly, is that the numbers will be such. You know, look, Tuvalu, sure, Maldives Islands, but Bangladesh, 150 million people. It's not often noticed in the West, but the most ferociously patrolled anti-immigrant border in the world is not in the West. It's the Indian border with Bangladesh, which is also, of course, for religious chauvinist reasons, because the Modi government doesn't want more Bangladeshi Muslims moving into India. So, you know, I mean, the bear case is simply that the numbers will become overwhelming, and those states which are unable to stop the migration will in fact collapse, and those that are will do so by means that will end liberal democracy. That's the bear case, which I pray doesn't happen.
I suppose the middle case, and we actually interviewed Stephen Markley, the author of The Deluge, which is a wonderful political thriller, kind of gaming out over 30 years in fiction, you know, some of these things exactly, with that border in Bangladesh being a prominent example of the kinds of things that, again, he paints some pretty horrific pictures about scenarios, about things that can happen. So that interview will come coming out next week. But look, I suppose before we let you go, because I appreciate we've kept you for more than I promised, Dr. Lieven, but the last question I wanted to ask you about is, to some extent in the UK campaign, it wasn't about climate, it became about jobs, it became about reindustrialization, it became about, like, energy independence, like learning from perhaps some of the choices that were made by the Biden administration in the States. You're sitting in the States right now. I am observing this from afar. Many people are going like, yeah, climate doesn't really seem to be part of the conversation. And what you've pointed to in your piece, you know, from last week in The Guardian, how do we actually have a conversation about this, you know, in an election environment? Or is it, in fact, the best case scenario that everyone just keeps shtum, who actually wants to do something productive about this and hopes that the other side doesn't win, and then we kind of fix things later? I mean, it seems like a no-win scenario. What is your take?
Well, I mean, I'm a strong advocate of the idea of a Green New Deal, and also of the whole idea of building national, or in the European case, European resilience. You know, energy independence, absolutely. Food, you know, grow your own food. One of the secrets of Russia's ability to go on waging the war in Ukraine is simply that they grow all their own food. They don't need to import. And that obviously indicates a move to alternative energy. It involves a move which we should also then try to spread to the rest of the world, of new forms of agriculture. But the thing is, you know, it also, this costs money. And this was the other point of my piece. It is, we do not have the money to do this and build up huge military forces against Russia, and in the case of the US, spend a fortune containing China, and keep armed forces on standby to intervene in the Middle East, which is to a very great extent a problem of our own creation. I mean, the point is, we've got to make choices. Now, they're hard choices, you know, but it's bloody obvious that in the run-up to the, you know, the Russian invasion of Ukraine, nobody in the West was thinking about the implications for climate change. If they had, yes, it would have been a hard choice, but we would have tried to reach some form of compromise with Russia. Because if we go on down the present path, I mean, A, it's simply the distractions. I mean, why is the media not seriously concentrating on climate change? Well, because there's too much else going on. There's the war in Ukraine. There's the war, and of course, then there are the huge institutional factors which constantly feed these into the into the media, as opposed to climate change. But we just will not have the money to do what we need to do if we continue down the present path. And of course, also by continuing, you know, policies of geopolitical confrontation, we will mean that the Chinese won't have enough money either, although they've done much better than we have. Will the Indians? Will spend their money on tanks and aircraft and not on alternative energy? Because, yeah, there just isn't the money to go around.
Mm. Well, that's a cheery note. I'm so glad we had you on, Dr. Lieven.
I like to spread optimism.
but look, I think if there is an optimistic note, I think it's the fact that, you know, there are people like yourself who can state and lay out these choices that policymakers still, because we are human and can make these choices, actually have the ability to make. And so I do hope that your piece and the counsel that you offer is listened to. I'm not super optimistic, but I'm hopeful that we
pessimism
will
of the
there.
Intellect, optimism of the will.
There we go. I'm not sure where that's from, but I love it. I'm going to use it on a mug. Gramsci, look at you. Like, gosh, for a guy of the right, traditionally, like you've got a lot of interesting references, my friend.
I am politically anymore.
Who does? Dr. Anatol Lieven, thank you so much for coming on Wicked Problems. I hope we can get you back soon. And I hope that your election observing for the next 6 weeks in the United States goes well and you stay safe, because I hope that's not even an issue.
Hopefully. Thanks a lot.
So big thanks to Dr. Anatol Lieven of the Quincy Institute for really manfully fighting through a cold, which I'm not sure if... He managed to give me something across the optical fiber line there, but I've been suffering myself the last couple of days since then for some reason. But yeah, I suppose it's one of the reasons that this has been so hard to talk about for so long is the fact that it doesn't really lead to a lot of super positive, optimistic kind of conversations.
It's very hard for a policymaker to hang their hat on something that has that range of uncertainty. And for the average person, if you tell them you're about to go over a cliff and there may be nothing we can do about it, it's likely that with a lot of people, it disempowers them and they give up. There have been studies of this.
Always look on the bright side of life.
And yet, this is where we are. That, by the way, was Michael Oppenheimer from Princeton. No relation as far as I know, but who was also speaking on that panel with David Wallace Wells and Stefan Rahmstorf. So before we let you go, if you're a subscriber, you'll hear conversations which we've borrowed from the New York Times, as well as a little bonus segment on Kevin Roberts, the head of the Heritage Foundation, behind that little thing you might have heard of called Project 2025. Which I'm looking at some polling yesterday, has a 4% approval rating in the United States and a 54% disapproval rating, which is slightly less than genital warts and measles. So anyway, it should be interesting to see, given that he's super, super pumped about what would happen if, in fact, as a flip of the coin might result in happening in a couple of weeks, Donald Trump has returned to the White House. Good luck.
Just before you draw your terminal breath.
There's a lot of bad stuff starting to happen due to climate change already. How much are you going to be concerned, or should you be concerned, today about something that may or may not happen 50, 100, 200 years from now? I think it's appropriate to regard it as part of a bundle of risks. But it shouldn't be the dominant one in your mind. What should be dominant, and is dominant in my mind now, as someone who's worked on the ice sheets for a long time, another tipping point, is that we have these impacts, we are not adapting to them successfully. Our government hasn't set up either the institutions, that is the US government, or the finances, or the research necessary to really understand what we should be doing now to protect ourselves. And as a result, we're marching into the next 30 years, a period over which it almost doesn't matter how much we reduce emissions. We're going to get the same increase in short-term impacts, record heat, too much rain and rainstorms, probable intensification of hurricanes, etc. You've heard the list. And, you know, we don't have a plan. And that's not just the U.S. government, it's many other governments. It's not just at the national level, it's at the state level. We don't have the money in it, we don't have the plans. I worry more about that than I worry about these large-scale tipping points. And if we decided to grapple with the short-term risk, we would probably do more or less the same thing that we're going to do to deal with the AMOC, for instance. What we're going to do, we've got to cut emissions as quickly as is feasible. We're not doing that. We could do better. We're doing better than we used to.
Hey, thanks for sticking around. And as a subscriber, then we're going to give you a little bit more of that conversation between Michael Oppenheimer, Stefan Rahmstorf, and David Wallace Wells. Then I'm going to bring you an extra segment with Kevin Roberts, the head of the Heritage Foundation, which for some reason the New York Times decided they would invite to New York Climate Week. And you can judge for yourself whether or not you feel like some of the arguments that he's putting forward are in good faith or ones that we need to figure out some other way of dealing with. Cheers.
Climate science keeps telling us that things are really quite scary and will be even scarier if we don't change course pretty rapidly.
A very clear definition, and that is a tipping point, is when a physical state is not changing because it is pushed further, but at some point self-amplifying feedbacks take over, and then it changes further without further pushing by itself, unstoppable.
This is really a remapping of the world's weather and biological and climate systems at a very basic level.
If I tell you your plane that you're flying to somewhere has a less than 10% chance of crashing, I don't think you would find that reassuring. It could even, that's not ruled out that we cross this tipping point in the next few years. That is a reason of concern.
It could be triggered any place between 1.5 and 8 degrees Celsius
above pre-industrial levels. We're now around 1.2 degrees. And it could take about anywhere between 50 and 300 years to play out. Deaths from heat waves, 60,000 people died in Europe in 2022, for instance, from excess heat, a lot of which was due to the buildup of the greenhouse gases. If we don't learn how to adapt, it may become irrelevant what the AMOC does or does not do, because we may be toast just from these more quotidian things that we're unfortunately sort of seeing more and more. The human race isn't going to go extinct, but life would become very hard for a lot of people. As usual, it's poorer people in poorer countries. They take it in the neck mostly from things like this, but not, it'll affect us too in a significant way.
How do you balance those two sets of risks in your mind? How do you think about how we as a society should be approaching them and balancing our own focus between the things that we know are coming and have some clear picture of, and the things that we're just scared might be happening?
It's simply us to do what has been unanimously decided by the world's countries already, namely trying to limit warming to 1.5 degrees. Of course, this is hardly possible anymore, 1.5, but we can kind of stop at 1.6 or 1.7, and we should really try to do that.
The Chinese are moving like crazy to take over large parts of the renewable energy business, and not just the energy, but the users of the energy, like cars, high-speed trains, etc. So that, you know, that isn't great for American labor, maybe, but it's good for the world in a way. Humans have done this forever. They create problems, and by and large, although not entirely, we clean them up afterwards. Now, the world looks particularly shabby right now, but we're still going to be here, and we ought to make the best of the fact that we're not going to disappear. We need to set up the mechanisms so that we don't get inured to the whole thing. And if we get inured to it, we're turning over to our kids and grandkids a miserable world.
We have to manage the unavoidable, but avoid unmanageable climate change. And crossing tipping points is kind of getting into the unmanageable climate change regime.
Please welcome to the stage the president of the Heritage Foundation, Kevin Roberts. Hi, Kevin. Thanks for joining me.
Yeah, thanks. You know, I was as surprised to get this invitation as I was to be invited to Davos. But I'll go anywhere to talk about how the climate agenda is ending the American dream.
Ending the American dream. Okay, well...
Am I the one who is Delulu, or this lady is Delulu?
So, quick question. You're the New York Times, and you have a whole big space at New York Climate Week, and you decide, like, do you know what we want? We want the guy that we want to be like our super controversial speaker this year to be somebody who is head of an organization that wrote a blueprint for some really, well, interesting stuff. So extreme that, in fact, Donald Trump has tried to disavow having anything to do with the plans which are being drafted on his behalf for his administration, should he win in a few weeks. You know, 200 of them were former staffers of his. And of course, his vice presidential nominee, J.D. Vance, wrote the foreword for a book which has been unfortunately delayed in publication until after the election. So shall we do a little bit of an exploration through this conversation, which the New York Times decided to platform at New York Climate Week, to see some thoughts about what the head of the organization that produced Project 2025, where climate tech, climate policy, et cetera, might be going. Let's kick off.
We have taken this idea of an energy transition, and I'm just, for the sake of having a friendly conversation, although we do have differences of opinion, I'm going to ascribe altruistic motives to what you're trying to do.
So, translation, y'all might be a bunch of soy boys who are trying to undermine the manhood of something, I don't know. Just for the sake of argument, I'll grant you some altruistic motives. We're off to a good start.
Even if that's the case, this has been so artificial, it has been so accelerated that this energy transition is actually harming people far more than any of the harms that you would cite from so-called climate change. In fact, there are many good studies from completely objective sources, including my colleagues and scholars at Heritage, that show that there's actually been a reduction in climate deaths, climate-related deaths, over the last century by 98%.
I mean, what are we doing with this fucking guy? Jesus. I mean, if this guy was not somebody who apparently, according to reports this week, you know, killed a neighbor's dog with a shovel because it was barking too much, I might feel some scintilla of like, yeah, maybe you're mistaken or somehow misled or anything else. But no, I think you're just a bad un. And yeah, objective studies. Okay. But yes, we invented air conditioning. We invented things like more efficient heating, like heat pumps. But let's not talk about that. And of course, you know, insulation. But sure, climate-related deaths. Yeah, 100%. Let's go with that.
That doesn't mean that we're rejecting that humans have an effect on climate. Clearly they do. That unanimity of scientists that you mentioned, be careful not to be too abusive with that, because you know better than anybody that there's a variety of perspectives on the extent of that.
We are, as political conservatives, also...
And yeah, that is Django snoring in the background because, like, he's heard this all before, has a view. But, like, really? We're doing that still? That there's not unanimity on the effects of, human activity on the climate? Okay, cool.
This is the final thing, to answer your question. We are, as political conservatives, also conservationists of the environment.
Great. Some Teddy Roosevelt. This is really encouraging. Come on.
What we're saying is stop using the imposed will of the federal government... which probably is way too politicized, and imposing that on the American people. If, in fact, you build a popular consensus about this energy transition, public policy ought to reflect that. And by the way, the thrust of all of the work that we do in Project 2025, whether it's on this topic or others, is actually a corrective to the politicization of the federal government when it comes to these related policies. That's the kind of thing that we want to fix on behalf of the American people.
Okay. So, just to be clear, Kevin Roberts is recording this after the last couple of months where Project 2025 has become like the least popular political proposal in the history of American politics. And the polling, as I mentioned earlier, is... 50 points underwater, like slightly less than genital warts or measles. But we'll double down. Now, you might ask yourself, why would we do that if you're him? I mean, what could be the incentive? Who possibly could make it worth your while to defend the indefensible? We might come back to that.
Throughout Project 2025, you propose essentially rolling back or eliminating many of the ways in which the government supports independent research and gets it out to the American
public. It's highly politicized. The most important thing that
in what way? When you say it's highly politicized.
Let me answer your first question. I'll come back to that because it's really important, this point that you raise about what our belief is regarding government-funded scientific research. It's got one purpose. Most of this, or a lot of this, I am kind of a weather nerd, so I pay attention to those agencies that are in the Department of Commerce. It is to provide data for policymakers. And let's keep in mind, and maybe this is sort of a philosophical rub that we have friendly between us, the policymakers are in Congress. They're not in the administrative state. And they're in Congress in the ideas of our founders because it reflects the will of the American people. But you think about what we're trying to do with scientific research inside government, we're trying to streamline it. We're trying to make sure that everyone realizes that while it plays a role, we're conservatives, we believe that there is a role for government, that government doesn't have a monopoly on scientific knowledge. And if you think about the research grants that also flow from the Department of Education, which, as you know, we also want to eliminate yesterday, that doesn't mean that that comes...
I mean, look, I'm not a saint. I've trained some of the most really interesting people over 30 years
do with environments like this, interviews like this. And it's very rare you get a performer who absolutely has no shame whatsoever, just strings one non sequitur after the other to basically distract you from the fact that he's never going to answer your fucking question. It's very rare. It's like a 1 in 1,000 ball player. You got to respect craft, I guess.
The issue with China right now on the climate front is that they are racing ahead with the production of renewables. They are leading in an enormous global industry. Their EV sales are wildly outpacing ours. All of this is allowing them to get a huge head start in what analysts around the globe anticipate to be a multi-trillion dollar market. Are you not concerned that the U.S. is going to lose a step to China, given your concern about our competitiveness, by not investing in these same technologies that we see China going so far with?
Should we, let's see if he answers the question.
No, I'm not concerned at all, and I don't mean that in a way to be petulant. In other words, I'm enjoying this conversation thread with you about China, because the broader context, as you no doubt know, is that China has half the coal plants in the world, and their pollution is astronomical. At the time when you and the White House climate advisor say that the world is following the United States, it just isn't. And China's imposition of people buying electric vehicles is the...
This one is not ordinary Delulu. This one is Delulu level 9000.
Okay, at this point, you might be asking yourself, why is this fucking guy allowed this jamoke to basically get more airtime peddling this stuff? And because he's like a really powerful and important person in the United States who's going to have an incredible amount of power if the election goes the wrong way in 6 weeks. And this is how he talks. I'm sorry, I don't normally indulge myself like this, but... if you're still here, thanks for listening. But yeah, we've got a lot of work to do and have a lot of time to do it. So keep the faith. Speak soon. Over to you, Theo.
If you enjoyed this conversation, please share it and leave us a rating and review on Apple Podcasts or Spotify. It helps others find the show. For an ad-free experience, consider becoming a paid subscriber at wickedproblems.earth. You'll get our newsletter, show notes, and exclusive content. Wicked Problems explores the intersection of people, politics, technology, and capital, and whether it creates a future you'd want to live in. Wicked Problems is written and edited by Richard Delavan, with production assistance from me, Theodore Delavan. Special thanks to Sun Charmer for our phenomenal theme music. Thanks for listening. What I dreamed and live, knowing that road everywhere. Boy, you can't never see out. I would go down the road, Dal, but tell me what I'm down.